All idealization makes life poorer. To beautify it is to take away its character of complexity. It is to destroy it. Leave that to the moralists, my boy. History is made by men, but they do not make it in their heads. The ideas that are born in their consciousness play an insignificant part in the march of events. History is dominated and determined by the tool and the production, by the force of economic conditions. Capitalism has made socialism, and the laws made by the capitalism for the protection of property are responsible for anarchism. No one can tell what form the social organization may take in the future. Then why indulge in prophetic fantasies? At best, they can only interpret the mind of the prophet and can have no objective value. Leave that pastime to the moralists, my boy. Michaelis, the ticket of Leave Apostle, was speaking in an even voice, a voice that wheezed as if deadened and oppressed by the layer of fat on his chest. He had come out of a highly hygienic prison, round like a tub, with an enormous stomach and distended cheeks of a pale, semi-transparent complexion, as though for 15 years the servants of an outraged society had made a point of stuffing him with fattening foods in a damp and lightless cellar. And ever since, he had never managed to get his weight down as much as an ounce. It was said that for 3 seasons running, a very wealthy old lady had sent him for a cure to Mirrenbad, where he was about to share the public curiosity once with a crowned head. But the police on that occasion ordered him to leave within 12 hours. His martyrdom was continued by forbidding him all access to the healing waters, but he was resigned now. With his elbow presenting no appearance of a joint, but more like a bend in a dummy's limb thrown over the back of a chair, he leaned forward slightly over his short and enormous thighs to spit into the grate. "Yes, I had the time to think things out a little," he added without emphasis. "Society has given me plenty of time for meditation." On the other side of the fireplace, in the horsehair armchair where Mrs. Verloc's mother was generally privileged to sit, Carl Jung giggled grimly, with a faint black grimace of a toothless mouth. The terrorist, as he called himself, was old and bald, with a narrow, snow-white wisp of a goatee hanging limply from his chin, an extraordinary expression of underhand malevolence survived in his extinguished eyes. When he rose painfully, the thrusting forward of a skinny, groping hand, deformed by gouty swellings, suggested the effort of a moribund murderer summoning all his remaining strength for a last stab. He leaned on a thick stick which trembled under his other hand. "I have always dreamed," he mouthed fiercely, "of a band of men absolute in their resolve to discard all scruples and the choice of means, strong enough to give themselves frankly the name of destroyers, and free from the taint of that resigned pessimism which rots the world. No pity for anything on earth, including themselves, and death enlisted for good and all in the service of humanity. That's what I would have liked to see." His little bald head quivered imparting a comical vibration to the wisp of white goatee. His enunciation would have been almost totally unintelligible to a stranger, his worn-out passion resembling in its impotent fierceness the excitement of a senile sensualist, was badly served by a dried throat and toothless gums which seemed to catch the tip of his tongue. Mr. Verloc, established in the corner of the sofa at the other end of the room, emitted two hearty grunts of assent. The old terrorist turned slowly, his head on his skinny neck, from side to side. And I could never get as many as three such men together. So much for your rotten pessimism, he snarled at Michaelis, who uncrossed his thick legs, similar to bolsters, and slid his feet abruptly under his chair in sign of exasperation. He a pessimist? Preposterous! He cried out that the charge was outrageous. He was so far from pessimism that he saw already the end of all private property coming along logically, unavoidably, by the mere development of its inherent viciousness. The possessors of property had not only to face the awakened proletariat, but they had able to fight amongst themselves. Yes, struggle, warfare, was the condition of private ownership. It was fatal. Ah, he did not depend upon emotional excitement to keep up his belief. No declamations, no anger, no visions of blood-red flags waving, or metaphorical lurid suns of vengeance rising above the horizon of a doomed society. Not he. Cold reason, he boasted, was the basis of his optimism. Yes, optimism. His laborious wheezing stopped. Then, after a gasp or two, he added, "Don't you think that, if I had not been the optimist I am, I could not have found, in 15 years, some means to cut my throat? And in the last instance, there were always the walls of my cell to dash my head against." The shortness of breath took all fire, all animation out of his voice. His great, pale cheeks hung like filled pouches, motionless, without a quiver. But in his blue eyes, narrowed as if peering, there was the same look of confident shrewdness, a little crazy in its fixity, they must have had while the indomitable optimist sat thinking at night in his cell. Before him, Karl Yundt remained standing, one wing of his faded greenish havelock thrown back cavalierly over his shoulder, stared in front of the fireplace. Comrade Ossipon, ex-medical student, the principal writer of the FP leaflets, stretched out his robust legs, keeping the soles of his boots turned up to the glow in the grate. A bush of crinkly yellow hair topped his red, freckled face, with a flattened nose and prominent mouth cast in the rough mold of the Negro type. His almond-shaped eyes leered languidly over the high cheekbones. He wore a gray flannel shirt. The loose ends of a black silk tie hung down the buttoned breast of his serge coat, and his head, resting on the back of his chair, his throat largely exposed, he raised to his lips a cigarette in a long wooden tube, puffing jets of smoke straight up at the ceiling. Michaelis pursued his idea, the idea of his solitary reclusion, the thought vouchsafed to his captivity, and growling like a faith revealed in visions. He talked to himself. indifferently to the sympathy or hostility of his hearers, indifferent indeed to their presence. From the habit he had acquired of thinking aloud, hopefully, in the solitude of the four whitewashed walls of his cell, and the sepulchral silence of the great blind pile of bricks near a river, sinister and ugly, like a colossal mortuary for the socially drowned. He was no good in discussion, not because any amount of argument could shake his faith, but because the mere fact of hearing another voice disconcerted him painfully, confusing his thoughts at once. These thoughts that for so many years, in a mental solitude more barren than a waterless desert, no living voice had ever combated, commented, or approved. No one interrupted him now, and he made again the confession of his faith, mastering him irresistible and complete, like an act of grace. The secret of fate discovered in the material side of life, the economic condition of the world responsible for the past and shaping the future, the source of all history, of all ideas, guiding the mental development of mankind and the very impulses of their passion. A harsh laugh from Comrade Ossipon cut the tirade dead short in a sudden faltering of the tongue and a bewildered unsteadiness of the apostle's mildly exalted eyes. He closed them slowly for a moment, as if to collect his routed thoughts. A silence fell, but what with the two gas jets over the table and the glowing grate, the little parlor behind Mr. Verloc's shop had become frightfully hot. Mr. Verloc, getting off the sofa with ponderous reluctance, opened the door leading into the kitchen to get more air, and thus disclosed the innocent Stevie, seated very good and quiet at a deal table, drawing circles, 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 innumerable circles, concentric, eccentric, a coruscating whirl of circles that by their tangled multitude of repeated curves, uniformity of form, and confusion of intersecting lines, suggested a rendering of cosmic chaos, the symbolism of a mad art attempting the inconceivable. The artist never turned his head, and in all his soul's application to the task, his back quivered, his thin neck sunk into a deep hollow at the base of the skull, seemed ready to snap. Mr. Verloc, after a grunt of disapproving surprise, returned to the sofa. Alexander Ossipon got up, tall in his threadbare blue serge suit under the low ceiling, shook off the stiffness of long immobility, and strolled away into the kitchen, down two steps, to look over Stevie's shoulder. He came back, pronouncing oracularly, "Very good, very characteristic, perfectly typical." "What's very good?" grunted inquiringly Mr. Verloc, settled again in the corner of the sofa. The other explained his meaning negligently, with a shade of condescension and a toss of his head towards the kitchen. "Typical of his form of degeneracy, these drawings, I mean." "You would call that lad a degenerate, would you?" mumbled Mr. Verloc. Comrade Alexander Ossipon, nicknamed the doctor, ex-medical student without a degree, afterwards wandering lecturer to working men's associations upon the socialist aspects of hygiene, author of a popular quasi-medical study in the form of a cheap pamphlet seized promptly by the police, entitled The Corroding Vices of the Middle Classes, special delegate of the more or less mysterious Red Committee, together with Carl Jungt and Michaelis for the work of literary propaganda, turned upon the obscure familiar of at least two embassies that glance of insufferable, hopelessly dense sufficiency, which nothing but the frequentation of science can give to the dullness of common mortals. That's what he may be called scientifically. Very good type, too, altogether, of that sort of degenerate. It's enough to glance at the lobes of his ears, if you read Lombroso. Mr. Verloc, moody and spread largely on the sofa, continued to look down the row of his waistcoat buttons. But his cheeks became tinged by a faint blush. Of late, even the merest derivative of the word science, a term in itself inoffensive and of indefinite meaning, had the curious power of evoking a definitely offensive mental vision of Mr. Vladimir in his body as he lived, with an almost supernatural clearness. And this phenomenon, deserving justly to be classed amongst the marvels of science, induced in Mr. Verloc an emotional state of dread and exasperation, tending to express itself in violent swearing. But he said nothing. It was Carl Jungt who was heard, implacable to his last breath. Lombroso is an ass. Comrade Ossipon met the shock of this blasphemy by an awful vacant stare, and the other, his extinguished eyes without gleams blackening the deep shadows under the great bony forehead, mumbled, catching the tip of his tongue between his lips at every second word, as though he were chewing it angrily. Did you ever see such an idiot? For him, the criminal is the prisoner. Simple, is it not? What about those who shut him up there, forced him in there? Exactly, forced him in there. And what is crime? Does he know that, this imbecile who has made him his way in this world of gorged fools by looking at the ears and teeth of a lot of poor luckless devils? Teeth and ears mark the criminal, do they? And what about the law that marks him still better, the pretty branding instrument invented by the overfed to protect themselves against the hungry? Red-hot applications on their vile skins, eh? Can't you smell and hear from here the thick hide of the people burn and sizzle? That's how criminals are made from your Lombrosos to write their silly stuff about. The knob of his stick and his legs shook together with passion, whilst the trunk, draped in wings of havelock, preserved his historic attitude of defiance. He seemed to sniff the tainted air of social cruelty, to strain his ear for its atrocious sounds, though as an extraordinary force of suggestion in this posturing, the all but moribund veteran of dynamite wars had been a great actor in his time, actor on platforms, in secret assemblies, in private interviews. The famous terrorist had never in his life raised personally as much as his little finger against the social edifice. He was no man of action. He was not even an orator of torrential eloquence, sweeping the masses along in the rushing noise and foam of a great enthusiasm. With a more subtle intention, he took the part of an insolent and venomous evoker of sinister impulses, which lurk in the blind envy and exasperated vanity of ignorance, in the suffering and misery of poverty, in all the hopeful and noble illusions of righteous anger, pity, and revolt. The shadow of his evil gift clung to him yet like the smell of a deadly drug, emptied in an old vial of poison, emptied now, useless, ready to be thrown away upon the old rubbish heap of things that had served their time.